My name is Bruce Mandela, and I'm the fellow from Minneapolis. And my presentation today is about bridging the gaps in the HIV treatment cascade for African-born immigrants in Minnesota. I work with the Children's Hospital, and I'll talk more about that as we get there. So as we begin, I would like to begin off by having a slight moment of silence for one of our colleagues. Our colleague right over there, who's called Joseph Smith Jr. He passed, this was in February, passed away to less than a month later. And he was a young man in his 40s who had, was one of the first beaten members who called up and was really interested in it. He was vibrant, as you can see in the picture, and used to be. He was energetic and vibrant, and contributed a lot in helping to fight stigma in the black community in Minneapolis by being a living, breathing example of how you can face the epidemic courageously. So I'll request you to have a moment of silence. May he also rest in peace. All right, so I'll begin by taking you to a brief tour to Minneapolis. That is Minneapolis over there. If you ever hear of Minneapolis, this is what it looks like. This is the sky. This is the downtown skyline of Minneapolis. Over here, the Minnehaha Falls. Oh, welcome, Daddy. So over here we have the Minneapolis skyline. Then right over here, these are the Minnehaha Falls. This is the green light that just came up recently. We have the Art Walker Museum, which is one of the largest in the country. Then this is a stone arch bridge, which was the place where most of the city was founded around. And then over here we have some of the theaters that Minneapolis is well known for. So Minneapolis was founded, its name derivation is from two words. The first word is Mni, which is a Dakota Sioux word. A Dakota Sioux is a tribe, one of the Native American tribes, and Mni is a word that refers to water, and Polis, as you all know, is a Greek word that refers to city, so they combined those two words, and it was one of the first school teacher in Minneapolis who came up with that. Minneapolis is ranked as one of the healthiest cities in the country, and as most of you know what Mayo is, we have Mayo health system over there, and our economy is highly dependent on the healthcare system too. So we've been ranked several times by the Commonwealth Group, by many groups, as the healthiest city in the country, and I'll talk more about that as we go on. So the economy is majorly dependent on commerce, finance, trucking services, and the healthcare field, like I say. The demographics, Minneapolis is 18.6% black, 18.6% of the population is black, but statewide, if you look at the entire state of Minnesota, it is a homogeneously white state with only 5% being people of color. Blacks generally in Minneapolis have not gained mobility into the middle class, and a study in 2008 showed it to be the city with the highest disparity for employment between blacks and whites. Blacks are three times more likely to be unemployed compared to whites, and that is very atypical for major cities. Most of the blacks stay in North Minneapolis, and this came later on in 2002 after a civil lawsuit against the city for keeping them in areas that were much worse than North Minneapolis, but North Minneapolis itself is not, it faces a lot of socioeconomic issues. All right, so the epidemiological profile, 29% of the new diagnoses that occurred in 2012 occurred in blacks. There are special things that we need to note. Women of color, even though they represent only 11% of the population of Minneapolis, represented 74% of the new infections that occurred. Then we have African-born immigrants, even though they are only less than 1% of the city's population, they represented 13% of the new infections that occurred in 2012. 81% of the new cases were through homosexual contact was the mode of exposure that was reported, and heterosexual contact contributed only 12%. 26% of the people living with HIV/AIDS in Minneapolis are black. Sorry, 26% of people living with HIV/AIDS in Minneapolis are black, were black in 2012. So this is basically to show you that it isn't, sexually transmitted illnesses aren't an only issue, they are not a standalone. I mean, HIV/AIDS is not a standalone issue. We have gonorrhea. Blacks, for every white person, you have 42 white people. Sorry, for every white person, you have 42 black people who have been diagnosed with gonorrhea. HIV infections, you can see it's 17.2. For every 17 people, you get only one white person. And chlamydia is also an issue. And this spreads across for all the other things, homicide, heart disease, diabetes, all those sorts of illnesses. There's a disparity that exists across. So this is this basically shows the incidence rates, and I mainly wanted to bring your attention to the incidence rate over here. As you can see, the incidence for every 100,000 people, 3.2 were diagnosed with HIV in 2012. Black Americans, the number is slightly higher, 39.2. Then the highest issue is over here. African-born immigrants have the highest rates of HIV/AIDS at 56.2. And you can see that it's across the board, they have the highest rates. So my needs assessment, I conducted a needs assessment in March, and the data collection, we got the data from the Minnesota Department of Health, carried out a couple of key 4-month discussions and group interviews. And I'll briefly talk about the key findings. The key findings we have, there are really high prevalence rates and high incidence rates of HIV/AIDS in our black community in Minneapolis. There are very few culturally competent programs that target this population. Most of the programs are being run by, most of the programs were not, this is an afterthought, targeting, developing specific interventions that are targeting the black community is an afterthought. It's not the primary focus for most of them. Then we have differing epidemics amongst the blacks. There are two different epidemics that are occurring in Minneapolis in the black community. When you look at the African-born immigrants, over 90% reported heterosexual contact as their mode of exposure. While when you come to the African-American community, more than, I don't have the figure off here, but it's more than 50% of them reported homosexual contact as a risk factor for HIV/AIDS. Then the other thing to note is that the new policy from CDC used high-impact programming. It's aging out some of the community-based organizations that have traditionally targeted the black community. So in my gap analysis, a couple of things that really came up. Minneapolis has one of the largest African-born populations in the entire USA. For the Somalis who moved over to the US, we have the largest population. The same thing for Liberian people. And as usual, you find a couple of Nigerians and everyone else, and one or two Ugandans. So in 2012, we had 2,300 immigrants, that primary immigrants. Primary immigrants refers to when they moved over from their home country, this was their first stop. Minneapolis was the first stop that they went to. The other thing we need to note is that in Minnesota is really progressive. It's one of the progressive states that we have. And in 2008, they passed a bill that they should get independent funding to help stop the epidemic within the black community. The other key thing is that African-born immigrants are usually late to care. There are three more times to be diagnosed with HIV/AIDS compared to their white counterparts. The community-based organizations that are in existence right now in Minneapolis are nationality inclined. You have, we have the African Assistance Program. It exclusively targets Liberians. You have the Sub-Saharan Youth and African Families, which targets Ethiopians. We do not have a community-based organization that looks at Africans as an entity. They are usually inclined to the nationality of the people they are serving. So to summarize the gap analysis, those are the three critical things that affect this community in accessing services. That is language barrier. Most of the individuals move from their native countries when they don't understand English or their enunciation isn't as good. Just like a case in point right over here. The other key thing is that there's diversity in this population. When you talk of Africa, most people when someone meets you, most times they ask, are you from Africa? And it's all the same thing as when you're from the United States. The United States, Alabama, Minneapolis, sorry. When you come from Arkansas or Minnesota, that's still all the US. And the culture will be somehow identical. There are a couple of things that will be overlapping. When it comes to Africa, you just move from Uganda to Kenya and everything is totally different. So that's the same issue that faces programs that are providing services. They assume all Africans are the same, but it's totally different. The Somali person will actually be much more similar to someone who's from some of the, like Iraq or Iran, because they're usually leaning towards Islam. Then a Ugandan will have something totally different. But that in most programming, most people don't know that. The other key thing that stands out is acculturation. Acculturation, those are the fancy words that I learned from Daniel during the fellowship. It essentially refers to when someone moves from a different culture to a new one, they have to adapt to the norms that are there. And for most people, it's difficult. For most Africans, you move in here and as told, I needed to get a credit card to get credit history. And where I'm from, credit card has always been something you shun because it will very fast lead you into debt. So it's only recently I took up a credit card because I thought it was disadvantageous, while to own anything I'll get most times will be off the credit history you have. Driver's license, I haven't even gotten mine yet because of the entire process I go through. You just know it's a lot of hectic. So for someone like me who has better education opportunities and interacts more, it wouldn't be as difficult as it is. But now imagine someone who comes in differently without the education that I have and the community that surrounds them as they try to do for my case. So this is a problem statement we came up with, that given African-born immigrants in Minneapolis have the highest incidence rate of HIV/AIDS, worst outcomes on the treatment cascade, unique barriers to care like acculturation and language barrier, how can the local beat and best leverage resources at their disposal in a sustainable and culturally accepted manner so as to address the disproportionate rate of HIV/AIDS cases in this community? So I've briefly given you a situation analysis of the issues we have at hand and what the problem is. So right now we came up with our goal to address this issue, and our goal is to reduce the incidence of HIV in the African community from 56 per 100,000 to less than 20 per 100,000 by 2019. I hope I'll still be in the country by then. So to address this, to attain this goal, there are tools that we have at our disposal, and the key tool that we have at our disposal is to form a local BTAN, a Black Treatment Advocates Network. So the BTAN essentially, I think you guys have seen this slide several times, but BTAN essentially is an initiative from the Black AIDS Institute with the mission of producing a nationwide network of highly trained HIV/AIDS advocates. And their goal is essentially to do the following: help, link, and retain people with living HIV/AIDS, increase demand for treatment, and the ultimate goal of BTAN is to ensure viral suppression within the Black communities that we all come from. So these are the project areas: treatment education, patient navigation, disclosure, advocacy. The logic model, I won't go through this. More eloquent people have gone through it, so I'll spare you the time. So building a BTAN in Minneapolis. This is a timeline. BTAN in Minneapolis hasn't been there for so long, but if we were to trace how it started in Minneapolis, in 2012, Minneapolis had the first CMC, the Community Mobilization Fellow, who was William Lawson. And he was the first individual who came over and tried to tell us about what the Black AIDS Institute was, what the BTAN is, and he's actually the individual who recruited me for this program. During that time, he hosted a couple of things that tried to create a name recognition for BTAN and the Black AIDS Institute. He hosted a house ball party, and then also made a couple of presentations to the HIV Planning Council and Shiloh Church, which is a large African-American church in Minneapolis. 2013-2014, when we started off this fellowship, the first things that I did were to have the initial discussions with the Department of Health, Minnesota Department of Health, the community-based organizations, and the community leaders on what a BTAN is and what we can attain with it. Then we started trying to look at how we can partner with the existing red and white fundings, because they're traditionally the ones that have the resources that can be utilized. Then we've done a couple of things that I'll talk more about. Like one of them was host an HIV awareness dinner at Chris Steakhouse. Then the launch and the training, and then the annual health fair that we've carried on. You'll see a couple of that earlier on. So these are the partners I've worked with. The Minnesota Department of Human Services, these individuals are the ones that help us. They provided trainers at whatever event that we have. Maytech is the ATEC in most of the other places, and they provided my transport for the last two times I've been here, and I've presented to them and will be presenting to them again when I head back to Minneapolis. Shiloh Temple Christian Church, this church has been fundamental in helping us to reach out to the church. Usually, like most research has said, most people in African-American community are more likely to listen to a pastor or a church leader than they are to listen to someone like me who's walking in and telling them overnight that HIV is out there and they can get infected. The Minnesota AIDS Project, which usually provides volunteers that help us on our events, the Urban League help us with their network. Minnesota Department of Health, I've worked a lot with these individuals. A School of Public Health for the researches that we do. Gilead has sponsored all the beaten activities that we've had, and have committed to always provide funding for us, which makes life really easy. Because once the money is out of the way, most of the other issues come slightly easier. Hennepin County, which also helps in providing accommodation and all that sort of stuff. So this is these are some of the individuals who showed up for our training. We had over 60 people who showed up, and I hope you guys can see the image, though it's a bit blurry. So the opportunities and challenges we've been faced, the opportunities we've had really motivated members. When we came up with this idea, I come from a more capitalistic nation. When we say that in the US we believe it's more capitalistic, but Uganda is almost worse off. We have a culture of Funiramua means how do I gain from whatever interaction we're having. So having these individuals who can volunteer for programs without providing anything was something that I thought would be challenging, but people got on board really fast and participated a lot. We've had unbelievable support from partners. Like I said, my flight travel has been fully funded. We've had all the projects we've had. We just present the budget and the money comes in. And these other partners also provide individuals to help us out. There's diversity in the group. There's nothing boring as being in a room and you're all like-minded. But these individuals come from different backgrounds and they are eager to make a difference. The challenge is, like we said, limited resources. It still remains an issue because you don't know how much you'll always get at the end of the day. So it somehow limits your imagination in certain ways. Time constraints, I've been doing a couple of things at the same time as doing this fellowship, which makes it difficult. And the third thing, which is not up there, is trust the process. There's nothing more difficult than trusting the process. But Rebecca likes it so much. So the trainings we've had, the first training was on February 16th. And the topic was HIV in black churches and the role that the church can play. The presenter was the Jackets director. He's from Baltimore, but Mr. Baltimore left. He's called Derek Spencer, and we had around 45 church leaders. It took place at Chris's Steakhouse, and it was the first time we got to reach out to the church and tell them about what we're doing and the avenues that are available for them to partner with us. The successes were, and at the same time we also got to find out what are the major barriers when they hear what HIV AIDS, why don't they want that said in church, and how can we do that differently. The major challenge was continuity, how to continue having this sort of events and access. Day two, I was in February 27th, that's almost 2 weeks later, and these are the presentations we had. We had Laura Hoyt, who's a physician at Children's Hospital, presented. Then she presented the HIV AIDS primary care. William Lasson, a pharmacist with Alina Health, presented about ARVs. Then we had another pharmacist talk about adolescents and young adults, and she was a sponsored speaker from Gilead. On the third day, we had Alicia Beach, who did an awesome job. She did a really good job in talking about the beatdown and how the members who are present could participate. Then we had Syndemics, talked about the concept of Syndemics, and it was another physician from Children's Hospital. Then we had someone from the Minnesota Department of Human Services talk about the Ryan White services that are available and how individuals can access them. And we closed off that day with HIV and minorities. So this is essentially how it looked like. That is Laura White was saying about HIV life cycle. And most of the members had, we carried out a couple of assessments afterwards using the survey method you like a lot, but over 95% of the people had a good predisposition towards this, and they really loved the concept and were eager to have more trainings like this. So engaging traditional Black institutes, institutions, our core thing coming into this community, the messenger matters. For me, the major issue was I wanted to work with both communities, the African American community and the African born immigrant community. In the African American community, it's a bit different. If you speak differently, sometimes it causes, you know, it might not be the right flag bearer. So the first thing that I did going into it was to get the right people who can communicate and reach out more effectively than I could. And the individuals who stood in that position were the Stair Step Foundation, which is essentially, it's this awesome project that has about there are around 50 ladies, African American ladies in their 50s, 60s, 40s, and there's no, they have an unbelievable atmosphere when they sing. It's as if you've landed in heaven for a second. So that was the first agency I reached out to, and they've supported us a lot in carrying out this. The next group was the Shiloh Temple Church, which was it has a couple of pastors who are well respected in the community, and they've helped us reach out to more individuals. Then after that, the African-born community, there's only one collaboration across the countries. It's called, referred to as AWARD, the African World AIDS Day Collaborative, and they also helped a lot with this. Then the other thing is that we've had, Gilead has helped sponsor a lot of these activities, and also these two African immigrant population programs, the Brian Coyle Center and the African Assistance Program, have helped a lot in this program. So the project plan is divided to four areas like we talked about previously. The first part is the patient navigation part, and we decided to refer to our program as Minneapolis Connect. And the objectives of this were to recruit 20 African-born people living with HIV/AIDS, and then have a support group for them, and at the same time distribute fact sheet on service points in Minnesota. This group usually, they aren't very tech savvy, so they can't go to the internet and look for service points. So having like flyers to distribute out is usually much more effective. And that is what we decided. We develop flyers that we can give out to these individuals and tell them where they can find services, host monthly meetings, then create partnerships with CBOs and MDH. We want MDH to be able to recognize us and send more individuals our way. This project, we haven't fully implemented it yet. We have a couple of individuals who are coming in. The photo I put over here was my presentation to the Department of Health. It's super dark, I can't see anything. But anyways, I was presenting both my master's project, and I also presented to them about what BITAN is and why they should work with us. As you can imagine, when I was going through the chi-squares and the p-values, they were dozing off. But when I started talking about the African-born community and what we can do differently, most of these people, who included senior leaders in the Department of Health and people in the HIV Surveillance Department, were super excited and had more questions. Treatment and education, we refer to our program in Minneapolis as the HIV/AIDS Literate. Literate has two meanings. Literate can mean you've gone to school, literate can mean you're informed and knowledgeable about something. Our context here means they are literate and knowledgeable about HIV/AIDS transmission and all those issues. So our objective was to host 5 brown bag lunches with over 30 members present by December 2014. We aren't doing so well on that yet, but we've had only one, and hopefully the other three can happen between December 30th. So over here is Bill Larson, the guy I told you about, the man, he's the one who introduced me to the what BITAN is and what it does. Then we also intend to host HIV awareness events, which we've already hosted. There's a couple I'll show you later on. Advocacy, we said for our program, No More Minnesota Nice for AIDS. And Minnesota as well, I refer to Minnesota Nice, people are always smiling and treat things. And we are ranked as one of the most chill states in the United States. So we're going to be less chill about HIV AIDS and do more. So the objectives were to publish two opinion editorials in the local newspapers. We haven't done that yet. Test 200 black church members by December 31st. We have some progress on that. We tested about 30, 40 people on one of the annual events that we host. The activities, I've talked briefly about that. Provide updates. We haven't done the second one, but the rest we are on track. So this is also another one of the presenters on HIV/AIDS and how to prevent it. Then disclosure, our fourth program on disclosure is in Minneapolis. We said title it Speak to Beat HIV, and our objectives were to develop a speakers bureau from our support group. Then create 5 videos of patient disclosure by December 2014. We haven't done much on the second one. Then activities were supposed to provide tutorials to these individuals so that they can reach out earlier on. This is one of the individuals who was talking on our HIV AIDS awareness event. Okay, process and outcome evaluation. This is an evaluation plan that we have so far. As you know, there are 4 project areas: treatment, education, disclosure, patient navigation, advocacy, and evaluation questions we had at each point were ensure that how many sessions should be told, who should be an attendance, who should we invite to these sessions, how can we gauge the satisfaction that people have with the work that we're doing. We'll collect this by observation and pre and post tests. Disclosure, which stories should be shared with the public, what is the ideal format for storytelling, information required, we shall need to find out from the community what sort of stories are more likely to encourage someone to test and take action. Patient navigation, we had our support group, who should be in our support group, how can we encourage attendance. Then the information required at the service points and how to get these individuals in. The data collection tool we use is document review. Advocacy wants to focus on the Affordable Care Act. And so the information, the evaluation question is what updates are happening in the PPACA, Presidential Protection, I won't venture into that. The Affordable Care Act, essentially, what agencies should be recruited. Information required mainly will be done by observation, and then we'll have focus group interventions and key personnel interview. So this is a very light budget. It's only 19,000, which is pocket change for some individuals like Ken. that is how we tend to invest the money that we have. So the successes we've had so far, successes and challenges, I'll begin off with the challenges. The first one is there are conflicting priorities. Most of the people that we tend to recruit for the beaten are individuals who have a full-time job working in HIV AIDS arena. And when you tell them, oh, in your free time, come and join me, we shall do more HIV work, it might not be the best idea to do that, but they've really been troopers and come in and done a lot of the work. And there's limited funding, as Jamal eloquently said earlier on, this is a volunteer job essentially. And it makes life very difficult when you're carrying out projects when you can't estimate how much you have for most of the work you'll be doing. There are time constraints. I had as a full-time student and pursuing like 100 other things, while at the same time being a fellowship, which made it really difficult. There's difficulty getting the right partners and getting them on the table. Most individuals, when you walk in, the first question they usually ask, which is expected, is how do I benefit from that? And we're working on how to make a stronger case for that. So the success is so far, the fellowship has helped a lot in developing capacity of our Children's Hospital in Minnesota runs the perinatal and the pediatric HIV/AIDS program. So these trainings that we see from here, most of the information is taken back and shared with the members of this team, and it has helped a lot. We replicate the information and they're able to get up-to-date information on what is happening in the HIV/AIDS world. And at the same time, we're working with the physicians to provide more culturally competent programming and environment for the clients that do come in. So another success was September last year. I was a speaker at the Congressional Black Caucus Conference, and it provided a really huge opportunity to have a discussion at the national level and build my competencies and skills as a leader in this field. In June this year, we hosted the annual HIV/AIDS awareness event. This was the first time we were doing it, and we hosted it at the Crown Plaza Hotel. We had a magnificent turn up. We had over 150 people turn up, and as you can see, what we decided to do for that event was to do the line dancing. So later tonight, I'll have a couple of moves to bust as
right.
I learned my line dancing along the way. So Gilead committed to sponsoring the future events. So this will be a great opportunity for us. Conclusion and recommendations. There are a couple of ongoing projects. One of them is right now, I'm actually, my master's project was in HIV/AIDS. I was looking at the predictive variables for HIV testing in Minnesota. And from that, there are two research projects that have come up. One of them exclusively targets African-born, how the African-born communities can get better services in Minnesota. Then the other project looks at care, and it's comparing HIV care between Hennepin County Medical Center and Jamaica Clinic. And we are trying to analyze how care is different and what is the right way of assessing someone being in care. Because the metrics that are there for assessing someone being in care are kind of fuzzy right now. So this research will probably inform how to better quantify someone being in care than saying they've had a visit every 3 months over the last 1 year. And both of the projects have been funded already, and these are some of the partners we'll be working with. These are the two lead PIs on the two projects, and this is the HIV surveillance coordinator in Minnesota, and that is the state epidemiologist. We also, on August 8th, are going to have an annual Cedar Riverside Health Fair. Cedar Riverside is a Somali community in Minnesota, and we intend to carry out HIV testing on this day, and also to recruit individuals for BTAN, and also overall develop sensitization amongst individuals about HIV/AIDS and how to prevent it. These are the milestones we've had so far over the last, it's been less than 6 months, over 5 months. We are developing name recognition. We intend to have more individuals. When you talk about BTAN, for individuals not to ask what is that, but to start telling us more about it. There are lots of willing partners that have Gilead, Department of Health, who have come on board. We are also receiving a lot of invites to talk to individuals about BTAN and what it does. So a couple of activities we'll be doing for that. The church has really jumped on board, and they are pushing to carry out an HIV testing campaign, which will hope we haven't gotten funding for it, but hopefully we will. Gilead has really come on board to sponsor most of the events that we have. And then the trainings have been a really awesome opportunity for people to learn more. My conclusion is just one statement. It always seems impossible until it is done. That's what Nelson Mandela said, and I can't explain better than he did. It's really obvious, it's always impossible until it's done. HIV/AIDS is something that will end in our generation. We have the tools, and we have the ability, we have the people who will go out to the community and make the difference. Acknowledgement, I'd like to acknowledge a couple of people. I'll begin off with my parents, Alfred and Penina. So the most important thing they ever did for me was to lie to me as a child that I could be anything I ever wanted to be. So that is something I've kept that deception on as I grew older, and it works really well sometimes. Most times. Okay, that's shifting a bit. I don't know if it's Rebecca doesn't want to receive any recognition. I would like to thank the Black AIDS Institute staff. Denisha Clark, she's not in the room, but Denisha has really struggled with me. I usually send in my assignments like at 3 a.m., 3 days after the deadline, but she already is sweet and she's fine. She makes you feel better even when you know you're messing up. The same thing with Rebecca. Rebecca is with Rebecca, she will make a lot of noise. By the end of the day, you'll be fine. Rania, who managed to keep on a full-time job and be pregnant and deliver at the same time, which is awesome. Lisha sent me a great email today morning. She said, I'm already an adopted son. So the only word I need to learn is how to say yeah. Is it?
Yeah.
Instead of you all, say yeah. I'll be a proper southerner, which I intend to be. Then the fellows, this is an amazing, has been an amazing community. You guys have learned so much from everyone, and it's been a great time together. I hope you'll celebrate tomorrow and tonight later on. UCLA staff, these guys have been there and they've told us that it was a pleasure learning from leading researchers who are doing the work that is happening right now. Bitan Minneapolis, Bill Larson, guy who introduced me to this, Kelly Robinson works with the Shiloh Temple Church, Ned D. Windham who helped organize the, these are the key individuals, there are more names I couldn't put up, but these are the people who have really been there and done most of the work that needs to be done. Children's Hospital, Catherine Patterson, who served as my supervisor, Laura Hoyt, who's a physician, and Monica Yugu. All right, I think I'm done. Thank you.